Again, brothers, sisters, everybody sing. Gonna bring the flame, I'll show you how. Got a question for you, better answer now. Yeah.
Am I your
This is Lake Effect Radio.
Good morning. This is the News at 10 here on Lake Effect Radio on this day, the 28th of March, 2016. Apologies if my voice is peaking a bit. My headphones are not exactly in the best of shape right now. Today, first off this morning, Pope Francis has condemned a Easter suicide bombing by Islamist militants that killed at least 70 people in Pakistan, many of them Christians, and demanded the country's authorities protect religious minorities. Addressing thousands of people in St. Peter's Square, the Pope said Pakistan had been, quote, bloodied by a hideous attack that massacred so many innocent people, mostly families of the Christian minority. The Pope, speaking from the window of the Vatican's Apostolic Palace to crowds in the square below, called yesterday's attack in a busy park in Pakistani city of Lahore, quote, a vile and senseless crime. Further, quote, I appeal to civil authorities in all sectors of that nation to make every effort to restore security and serenity to the population, and in particular to the most vulnerable religious minorities, he said. Pope Francis, leader of the world's 1.2 billion Roman Catholics, said he also prayed that God would, quote, stop the hands of the violent ones who sow terror and death. Pakistani authorities are searching for breakaway Taliban militants who once claimed loyalty to Daesh after a group claimed responsibility for the suicide bombing. Hold on a bit. That's a lot better, I think. The attack in Lahore, the power base of Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, killed mostly women and children enjoying an Easter weekend outing. Pakistan is a mostly majority Muslim state, but has a Christian population of more than 2 million. It was the deadliest attack in Pakistan since the December 2014 massacre of 134 children at a military-run academy in the city of Peshawar that prompted a big government crackdown in Islamist militancy. Quote, "We must bring the killers of our innocent brothers, sisters, and children to justice, and will never allow these savage inhumans to overrun our life and liberty," military spokesman Azim Bajwa said on a post on Twitter. Jamaat-ul-Ahrar, a faction of the Pakistani Taliban, claimed responsibility for attack late on Sunday night and issued a direct challenge to the government. Quote, "The target was Christians," a faction spokesman said. Quote, "We wanted to send a message to Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif that we have entered Lahore. Lahore is the capital of Pakistan's richest province, Punjab, and is seen as a country's political and cultural heartland. Sharif's office condemned the blast as a cowardly act and said a response had been ordered without elaborating. Lahore, markets and schools and courts closed today as the city mourned. Rescue Service spokeswoman Deeba Shanaz said at least 70 people were killed and about 340 wounded, with 25 in serious condition. The group has claimed responsibility for several big attacks after it split from the main Pakistani Taliban in 2014. Clear allegiance to Daesh, but later said it was rejoining the Pakistani Taliban insurgency. Meanwhile, Taliban militants fired explosives in Afghanistan's parliament compound on Monday as a top intelligence official and the caretaker minister of interior were due to speak, lawmakers and the insurgents said. Officials say no one was reported wounded. A Taliban spokesman claimed responsibility for the attack and said it caused heavy casualties. Of course, they're conflicting, so unless someone else comes in with, like, third-party data, then you don't know exactly what happened, other than explosions happened. The death toll from last week's bombings at Brussels airport and a metro station in the Belgian capital has risen to 35, according to the country's health minister. Four people who were being treated for the injuries have died in the hospital, Madi de Blac said. The death toll includes three suspected suicide bombers, so 32 innocent people died, basically. More than 300 people were also injured in the accident. Belgian officials have found the main building at Brussels International Airport, the main terminal building, presumably, to be stable after an initial investigation. Someone did not. I was just checking, make sure Daesh was properly called what it was, not spelling, so. Ugh. A statement published on the airport's website confirmed that technicians and independent experts had judged main and connector buildings be, quote, intact. The statement also disclosed that the locations where hand luggage and custom checks were carried out can also be used again. Airport officials are now discussing plans to install temporary check-in desks, but pointed out the process of identifying a suitable location was still being carried out in consultation with airlines and luggage handlers. Shortly after the announcement, Belgian media also reported that prosecutors in Brussels charged a second man in connection with a foiled attack in Paris. The man, identified only as Abderrahman A, was charged with involvement in the terrorist group, according to Belgian media. In a statement in French, state-owned Belgian news agency said prosecutors confirmed that the suspect had been arrested on Friday in Charbique after he was shot and wounded by armed police at a tram stop. It was not confirmed by however, by Belgian prosecutors. The reported arrest would be the second to be made in connection with the plot to stage another terror attack in Paris, after nine people were arrested for their suspected involvement in a terror attack in Belgium last Thursday. It is understood that the first arrest was made in Boulogne-Billancourt, west of Paris, where police detained Reda Cricket, 34, for his suspected involvement in a militant plot that officials believe was, quote, at an advanced stage. Considering I still have problems with this thing, how things are set up, as is usual on a Monday, we will cut to break. This is Leak Effect Radio.
You were listening to Lake Effect Radio. Keep rocking around the clock tower, guys.
Lakeland Community College. Opportunity starts here. Whether you're beginning college, changing careers, or brushing up skills, classes are offered at times that fit your busy schedule and for thousands less than four-year schools. Then complete your bachelor's degree with one of our university partners at Lakeland's Holden University Center. Still convenient, still affordable, all close to home. Lakeland Community College and the Holden University Center. Stay here, go far. Visit lakelandcc.edu to learn more.
Military veteran students who study at Lakeland first meet with a Veterans Affairs certifying official who processes and certifies educational benefits for eligible students. The staff has been phenomenal, said Lakeland student Michael Dugan, who is a retired Chief Petty Officer from the U.S. Coast Guard. The Veterans Lounge is a great place to frequent prior to class. It's great to be able to show up a few hours early, do some final prep, enjoy a snack, and be able to meet fellow veterans. A generous grant from Wells Fargo Advisors, LLC, helped to set up a Veterans Lounge in 2013. The space, complete with study areas, a computer and printer, a refrigerator, and a television, serve as a meeting point for student veterans on campus to connect. Each May, graduating student veterans are recognized at the college's Veterans Recognition and Graduation Banquet.
And we have returned here on Lake Effect Radio. This is still the news at 10. Syrian President Bashar al-Assad has hailed his troops' victory over a so-called over the Daesh group in the ancient oasis city of Palmyra as a, quote, important achievement. The loss of Palmyra represented one of the biggest setbacks for the ultra-hardline Islamist group since it declared a caliphate in 2014 across large parts of Syria and Iraq. The Army General Command said its forces took over the city with support from Russian and Syrian airstrikes, the opening up a huge expanse of desert leading east to Daesh strongholds of Raqqa and Deir al-Zor. Palmyra would become, quote, a launch pad to expand military operations against the group in those two provinces, it said, presumably the Syrian army, led under Assad, promising to, quote, tighten the noose on the terrorist group and cut supply routes ahead of their complete recapture. Mr. Assad, meanwhile, said the recapture of Palmyra was, quote, an important achievement and fresh proof of the efficiency of the Syrian army and its allies in fighting terrorism during a meeting with French parliamentarians in Damascus. He also hit out at the global coalition striking Daesh in Syria and Iraq, saying his army's victory, quote, shows a coalition led by U.S. and including more than 60 countries isn't serious about fighting terrorism. We only have air cover. We're only in the air there. We don't have troops on the ground. You don't want to know why? Politics. Anyway. Sorry. Amaq, a news agency close to Daesh, said its fighters launched a twin suicide attack against government forces in West Palmyra without giving details. Last time anyone claiming to be a nation, and in the last case they were actually a nation, trying to use suicide attacks as a serious tactic, didn't end well for them. Just ask, pretty much anyone in the Japanese archipelago. Syrian state-run television broadcasts from inside the city showing empty streets showed empty streets and badly damaged buildings. It quoted military sources saying Syrian and Russian aircraft were targeting Daesh fighters as they fled, hitting dozens of vehicles on the roads leading east from the city. Russia's intervention in September turned a tide of Syria's five-year conflict into the government's favor. Despite its declared withdrawal of most military forces 2 weeks ago, Russian fixed-wing aircraft and helicopters carried out dozens of strikes daily over Palmyra as the army pushed into the city. Lost Palmyra comes 3 months after Daesh fighters were driven out of the city of Ramadi in neighboring Iraq, the first major victory for Iraq's army since it collapsed in the face of assault by the militants in June of 2014. Daesh has lost ground elsewhere, including the Iraqi city of Tikrit last year, the Syrian town of al-Shaddai in February. The United States said the fall of Shaddai was part of its efforts to cut Daesh's link between its two major power centers of Mosul in Iraq and Raqqa in Syria. 2 days ago, the United States said it believed it had killed several senior Daesh militants, including Abd al-Rahman Qawadi, described as the group's top finance officer and aide to its leader, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. Daesh and al-Qaeda's Syrian branch, the al-Nusra Front, are excluded from month-long cessation hostilities in Syria that brought a relative lull in the fighting between government and rebels battling Assad in the west of the country. The limited truce has allowed indirect peace talks to resume at the United Nations in Geneva, sponsored by Washington and Moscow. However, progress has been slow, with the government and its opponents deeply divided over any political transition, particularly whether Mr. Assad must leave power. The Syrian Observatory from Human Rights said about 180 government soldiers and allied fighters were killed in a campaign to retake Palmyra, which is home to some of the most extensive ruins of the Roman Empire. Daesh militants dynamited several monuments last year, and Syrian television broadcast footage from inside Palmyra Museum showing toppled and damaged statues, as well as several smashed display cases. Ancient artifacts in the city are in much better shape than expected, Syria's antiquities director Mamoun Abdul Karim has said. He said much of the old city was intact, and his department will try to restore relics destroyed during the jihadist nearly year-long rule over the city. Quote, "We were expecting wars, but the landscape in general is in good shape," he said. "We could have completely lost Palmyra," he said. Known to Syrians as the Pearl of the Desert, Palmyra is a well-preserved oasis and boasts colonnaded alleys, elaborately decorated tombs, and ancient Greco-Roman ruins. Since an overran city in May of last year, Daesh destroyed Grand Temple of Bel, the shrine of Baal Shamin, and several funerary towers, which the ultra-conservative Muslim extremists see as blasphemous. You know what else is blasphemous? Daesh. That was not in the article. That was me, obviously. The jihadists used city's spectacular Roman theater for executions and murdered the 82-year-old former antiquities chief of Palmyra, which is ironic, considering that they consider that blasphemous, so why would they use that? Oh, wait, they're hypocritical assholes, right. Many of the most important ruins, including the Agora, Roman theater, and city walls, were only lightly damaged, current antiquities minister said. In any case, there are new images have emerged because of that, and you can look those up online if you so desire. Mine was actually sourced from the British Broadcasting Corporation, so. This was on Easter Sunday, so dateline of March 27, 2016. Pope Francis condemned those who failed to help migrants during his traditional Easter speech in Rome. The Pope said migrants often meant, quote, rejection from those who could offer them welcome and assistance. He also condemned terrorism as, quote, a blind and brutal violence that should be fought with, quote, weapons of love. The Pope was delivering his Ubi et Orbi to the city and the world message, to the city and the world message to thousands amid highly tight security in St. Peter's Square. Pope said, quote, the Easter message of the risen Christ invites us not to forget those men and women seeking a better future, and even more numerous throng of migrants and refugees fleeing from war, hunger, poverty, and social injustice. All too often, these brothers and sisters of ours are meet along the way with death or, in any event, rejection by those who could offer them welcome and assistance. Tens of thousands of migrants, mainly fleeing conflict in Syria and Iraq, are now stranded in Greece after European nations and Turkey agreed to a plan to shut their route to northern Europe. Pope Francis also offered a prayer for Syria. Quote, the risen Christ points our path to the hope of beloved Syria, a country torn by a lengthy conflict with its sad wake of destruction, death, contempt for humanitarian law, breakdown of civil concord. He expressed his hope for success at peace talks scheduled to resume next month. The Pope also urged people to use the, quote, weapons of love to combat the evil terrorism. He spoke of recent attacks in Belgium, Turkey, Nigeria, Chad, Cameroon, Cote d'Ivoire, and Iraq. And just taking a side here, considering that this is the same day that there was that attack in Lahore, I'm guessing, considering this is a very important thing to be done, that's done on yearly, this is probably pre-written, and regardless of whether His Holiness knew, Francis knew about the attacks at Lahore, he probably would not have directly mentioned it due to the, well, frankly, the freshness of the matter. Hence why I waited until presumably today to speak about it. I'm not Catholic, by the way, I'm just saying. These are just things I figure people should know. Back to the article and another quote from the Pontiff. May the risen Jesus Christ draw us closer on this Easter feast to the victims of terrorism that blind and brutal forms for violence, which continues to shed blood in different parts of the world, he said. The latest terror attack, which was on Brussels on Tuesday, left 28 people dead. The former king and queen in Belgium, Albert II and Paola, attended a mass on Sunday and met the Pope. Many pilgrims canceled their planned trip to Rome in the wake of the violence in Brussels, but the square is packed on Sunday, as was St. Peter's Basilica, when Pope Francis celebrated Mass on Saturday evening. In his homily in the Basilica, he called on Christians not to let fear and pessimism, quote, imprison them. He said, quote, today is the celebration of our hope, and it is so necessary today. Again, I'm not Catholic. I don't really think the Catholic Church gets the ideas that I think they got a lot of things wrong, doctrinally speaking. This is my own personal opinion on the matter, but those words are still true. on the other side of the world. Well, the other side of the world, I guess. South Korean activists sent tens of thousands of leaflets across the border across the inter-Korean border on helium balloons for the second time in 3 days, denouncing North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. Balloons carrying messages urging the country's citizens to defect are regularly launched by defectors, conservatives, and religious groups. The authorities, presumably South Korean, have stopped them in the past, citing public safety, because, you know, they could get shot. Pyongyang often threatens violent retaliations for the launches. Again, it's more of what I was saying. Many locals concerned about possible attacks from the north also oppose them. The latest balloon protests come amid heightened tension on the peninsula. Earlier on Monday, South Korea's Supreme Court rejected a challenge by North Korean defector Lee Min-bok involved in previous balloon launches to restrictions on his balloon campaigning. Balloons sometimes also carry dollar notes and even chocolate snacks. In 2014, North Korean soldiers attempted to shoot them down, leading to an exchange of fire across the border. Again, no surprise. The launches come at a time of heightened tension between the Koreas. North has carried out nuclear tests, satellite launches, and numerous missile firings this year, while South has pulled out of its Kaesong jointly operated industrial zone and is carrying out one of its largest ever joint military drills with the United States. The North occasionally flies its own propaganda leaflets to the South as well, and the South Korean military has loudspeakers near the border, broadcasting a mixture of political and pop content north. Because K-pop always works in convincing North Koreans to flee South. I'm almost out of information for you guys. Let's take another commercial break. I'm just seeing if there's a song that sort of piques my interest on the matter. Yeah, I think I found one. We will return. This is Lake Effect Radio. I don't know who put that on the car computer, but I despise him now. I truly do despise him, and I apologize for that brutally rubbish thing where someone just muted out the lyrics. Oh well, I suppose we'll just go to normal commercial break then.
Watch us live at www.livestream.com/lakelink.
Lakeland Community College. Opportunity starts here. Opportunity to be successful in a high-demand career. Opportunity to earn a degree and transfer credits to a four-year college or university. From your first class to your graduation, Lakeland will help you every step of the way. You're ready. All you need is an opportunity. And opportunity starts at Lakeland.
For the sixth year, Lakeland has been designated as a military-friendly school by GI Jobs Magazine. The list honors Lakeland as one of the top 15 colleges, universities, and trade schools, which do the most to embrace America's student veterans and ensure that they succeed on campus. Lakeland is also a Service Members Opportunity College approved by the State Approving Agency for Veterans. Lakeland's inclusion on the 2015 list of military-friendly schools was based on a criteria such as class flexibility, which includes evening classes, online classes, and weekend classes. Also, military-specific support services, ability for veterans groups, and networking.
Hey Lakeland students, pick up the latest issue of the Lakelander student newspaper to stay up to date with what's happening around campus. The Lakelander will keep you informed and entertained with all the latest campus news, music, reviews, political commentary, and everything in between.
17th annual poetry reading program Tuesday, April 12th at 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. in the Lakeland Community College Library, third floor C building, C3051, featuring readers from Lakeland's faculty, Bob Coughlin, Tom Highlander, Michelle James, and Lynn Mayhew. Followed by an open mic. Come and share your word. No registration required. Light refreshments will be served. Free and open to the public. For more information, please call 44 540-525-7424 for more information.
Be sure to watch us live on www.livestream.com/LakeEffect.
Book discussion group celebrating National Library Week. Read a book and join library staff in discussing of Bird by Bird, Some Instructions by Writing and Life by Anna Lofman. Wednesday, April 13th at noon in room C-2058. Second floor C building, free and open to the public. Call 440-525-7424 for more information. GradFest, Monday, April 11th and Tuesday, April 12th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. Everything you need for graduation on May 14th. Pick up your cap and gowns or commencement tickets. Order graduation announcements. Order class rings at the Lakeland main campus outside the bookstore.
I only feel angry when I see waste, when I see people throwing away things that we could use.
We don't do weather forecasts on Lake Effect Radio, so this should take care of the entire year for you.
It's cold! It's freezing cold!
The snow sucks. It spits all over your pants and it makes you look like a freaking hobo.
One reporter ventures outdoors to see if it really is hot enough outside to fry an egg.
I prayed during the winter months. I did not say, Lord, please bring the devil from hell and have him sit his ass crack on earth.
I mean, I never heard anybody say I'm going to Cleveland on vacation.
Lake Effect Radio.
Earn a bachelor's degree close to home through Lakeland's Holden University Center. Choose from a variety of degree programs from 9 Ohio colleges and universities. Taking classes your first few years at Lakeland will save you thousands. Register online for the Holden University Center Partnership Fair Tuesday, April 12th from 4 to 6 in the A Building Atrium. Learn more at lakelandcc.edu/UC. Lakeland's Holden University Center. Stay here, go far. Earn a bachelor's or graduate degree close to home through Lakeland's Holden University Center. Register online for the Holden University Center Partnership Fair Tuesday, April 12th from 4 to 6. Learn more at lakelandcc.edu/UC.
For personal research assistance, make an appointment with a Lakeland librarian. Stop by the library reference desk or call 440-525-7425 for more information. The library is located on the third floor of C Building.
Hey, this is Ian from Chill, and you're listening to Lake Effect Radio.
And hello there, this is Lake Effect Radio, and you're listening to more news here at 10 o'clock. Israel's reassigned its nominee for ambassador to Brazil, whose appointment the Brazilian president has refused to accept, apparently because the old nominee is a former settler leader. Dani Dayan will now become Israel's consul general in New York, ending a seven-month diplomatic standoff. Israel previously said it would not replace Mr. Dayan as its nominee. Mr. Dayan's appointment caused outrage among left-wing groups in Brazil, who lobbied President Dilma Rousseff to reject it. The Argentine-born official was chairman of the Yesha Council, an umbrella group representing Jewish settlers in the occupied territories from 2007 to 2013. The fate of Jewish settlements in the West Bank and East Jerusalem, land claimed by Palestinians for a future state, is one of the most contentious issues between Israel and Palestinians. The settlements are considered illegal under international law, though Israel disputes this, basically. I was going to say disregards, but that's not necessarily accurate. In a statement on Monday, Israel's Prime Minister's office announced Mr. Dayan's new appointment without any reference to Brazil. Mr. Dayan said his deployment to New York was, quote, a victory over the BDS, the pro-Palestinian boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement, which targets Israel politically, economically, and culturally. Quote, I think those elements who did not want a settler leader in Brasilia got a settler leader in the world's capital. He told an anti-BDS conference. You can't call New York the world's capital. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to call BS on that. That's not the world's capital. There is no world capital. And if you say such a thing, you're an idiot. Sorry. But Brazil is Israel's largest trading partner in South America, but relations have been tense since 2010, when Brazil said it recognized Palestinian statehood in the West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem. This out further in 2014, when Brazil recalled its ambassador from Israel in protest of what it called the, quote, disproportionate use of force by Israel in its summer offensive in Gaza. And then apparently the Israel Foreign Ministry threw a diplomat, tried to throw, I suppose, an insult by calling Brazil a diplomatic dwarf. If anyone's ever played Dwarf Fortress, that may be a compliment, possibly, if you look at it the right way, if you squint a bit. We'll go on to the weather. I don't want you anymore. And now the weather forecast for Cleveland, Ohio for the next several days. But first, a hazardous weather outlook has been issued for Cleveland, Ohio and surrounding areas, issued by National Weather Service in Cleveland, Ohio at 4 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time, Monday, March 28, 2016. This hazardous weather outlook is for Lake Erie, North Central Ohio, Northeast Ohio, Northwest Ohio, and Northwest Pennsylvania. Day 1, today and tonight. Gusty westerly winds are expected today behind a cold front. A few gusts may reach 40 miles per hour. Strong winds are expected close to Lake Erie. And that is all it. Nothing else beyond that. Today, a chance of showers before 5, then a chance of sprinkles after 5. Cloudy, high 47. Breezy, west wind 18 to 22 miles per hour. Gusts up to 39 miles per hour. Precipitation chance 30%. New precipitation amounts less than 1/10 of an inch. Tonight, cloudy, then gradually becoming partly cloudy, low 34. Northwest wind 8 to 10 miles per hour. Tuesday, sunny, high 44. Northwest wind 8 to 10 miles per hour. Tuesday night, mostly clear, low 34. Calm, becoming south wind around 5 miles per hour after midnight. Wednesday, mostly sunny, high 62. South wind 9 to 11 miles per hour. And Wednesday night, showers likely, mainly after midnight. Mostly cloudy, low 50. Breezy. Precipitation chance 60%. new precipitation amounts of less than 1/10 of an inch. And the last story for today, and I wanted to have a little bit of an addendum for it, but unfortunately I wasn't able to find the relevant video on YouTube. Alas, it would have been really funny if... I'm not going to spoil any further. Belgian riot police fired water cannon on Sunday to disperse far-right football hooligans who disrupted mourners at a shrine for victims of the Brussels attacks as police arrested several suspects in a series of new raids. In scenes that compounded a week of grief for Belgians, black-clad protesters shouting anti-immigrant slogans moved in on the makeshift memorial at the Place de la Bourse, where hundreds of people gathered in a show of solidarity. Under fire, Belgian authorities, meanwhile, detained four terror suspects after carrying out 13 raids as they seek to round up a web of jihadists with links to the carnage in the Belgian capital and to attacks in Plans, France. Clash between far-right demonstrators and police underscored tensions in Belgium after Tuesday's Daesh suicide attacks on the airport and metro system, in which 32 people died and 340 wounded. This was updated Quote, "This is our home!" and "The state Daesh accomplice!" Around 300 was chanted by about 300 hooligans using a proper term for Daesh, as they gathered near a square by a stock exchange building the AFP journalist witnessed. Oh! Some trampled on the carpet of flowers, candles, and messages left at the site by mourners in recent days, while at least one wore a mask with a well-known far-right symbol. Presumably one that looks very similar to crosshairs. Not necessarily advocating violence, but, you know, it'd be sort of ironic if someone put one right in the middle of this. Anyway, yes. Police urged mourners, which includes some Muslims, not to provoke the hooligans, but some chanted, quite reasonably, "Fascists, fascists, we're not having it." Bunch of kizzly motherfuckers. Riot police of helmets and shields corralled the hooligans before dispersing them with high-powered water jets, marshaling them onto trains out of the city. And if they come back, they'll be met with lead jets, perhaps. I don't know. Around 10 people were arrested, police told the AFP news agency. Brussels Mayor Yavan Mayor said police had done, quote, nothing to stop the hooligans coming to Brussels despite having advance warning, added that he was, quote, appalled that, quote, such things had come to provoke residents at the site of the memorial. Mourners gathered despite the fact the organizers earlier called off a, quote, march against fear in Brussels on Easter Sunday at the request of Belgian authorities, who said police needed resources for the attack investigations. No comment. In a homily at the medieval Cathedral of Saints Michael et Gedurel in Brussels, the Roman Catholic Archbishop of Malines, Brussels, Josef de Kessel, said the attacks, quote, defy understanding. No shit. We are confronted with the evil on an unimaginable scale, which causes so much innocent and useless suffering, the Belgian news agency quoted de Kessel as saying. Easter celebrates victory over evil, he said. Yes, although Jesus didn't exactly come get out of the tomb with rocket launchers and kalashnikovs, he did come victory over death. Yes. Meanwhile, the Belgian Crisis Center said 28 people had died in the airport metro attacks, down from the initial total of 31, which had included the three suicide bombers. That has been raised now to 32, unfortunately. A total of 340 people from 19 countries were wounded, of which 101 remained in hospital, 62 of them in intensive care. Those numbers probably should be revised in some fashion. As Belgium struggles to come to terms with the tragedy, recriminations continue over whether the authorities could and should have done more to prevent the carnage, as links to November Paris attacks by Daesh grew clearer by the day. It's a longer thing going on here. Most importantly, hindsight's 2020, and also, to those people, those hooligans, football hooligans, I'm gonna get a song ready for you, because you guys deserve it. Okay, I'll stop that now. We will now take a break, but we're not done yet. I still need to find that thing. All right, we will return here on the news at 10 in a bit. This is Lake Effect Radio.
local music spotlight on Lake Effect Radio. John Patrick Hawley, Downtown Blues.
That was John Patrick Hawley with Downtown Blues, a local music spotlight, which I will restart once we get done with this. But I finally found it. I finally found my formal response to those NWAs who decided that they are going to trample on the mourners effectively, especially on their hearts. Not literally, thank God. Of people in Brussels. if you have ever played Morrowind, this might trigger you. I don't care. Yes, cliff racers. I have absolutely no regrets on that matter. Absolutely none whatsoever. Why should I? Yeah, they're the kind of people that deserve to be haunted by cliff racers for the rest of their natural lives, which will hopefully be unnaturally cut short by said cliff racers with, I don't know, I would say corpus, but, you know, I don't want innocent people getting infected with it, so, I don't know, just hopefully they rip the flesh out from their necks or something. I don't know. Anyway, that will conclude the news at 10 for today. On the 28th of March, 2016. Thank you for listening. We will return on Wednesday as per usual. Whether John will be here or not is anyone's guess. You know, he has things that come up and are beyond his control, obviously. I try to be here. Can't always guarantee that, but I try to be here. And again, thanks you for listening. We will return at this time slot on Wednesday. Bye-bye.